In 2014, the question was when? When would the Hogs turn the corner? When would they see change? Finally, the answer arrived in impressive fashion.
The boat is coming home!
This season is all about how. How can they keep up the momentum? How can they keep pace with the rest of the West? How can anyone stop their backfield?
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to the 2015 Arkansas Razorbacks Preview Show. I'm your host, Peter Burns. That is former Arkansas Razorback quarterback Clint Sterner, and a man that wanted to try to tackle an LSU, but they didn't play at the same time, the great Marcus Spears. Gentlemen, the season is finally here.
So relieved to stop talking about what can be and really see what's going to happen.
Well, what's going to happen is we're going to show you some of the different storylines. Dan Enos, the former Central Michigan head coach, now the new offensive coordinator. Enos led the Chippewas to a bowl in each of the past three seasons, and he coached the number one overall pick of the NFL draft in 2013, tackle Eric Fisher. Now, Enos will have an experienced signal caller at his disposal. Brandon Allen's 25 career starts are more than any returning SEC quarterback, and he's one of the best in the SEC in limiting mistakes. Only 5 interceptions last season, second lowest in the SEC. Well, Allen, he might be asked to do a little bit more than avoid mistakes this season. That's because Arkansas's 10th leading all-time rusher, Jonathan Williams, will miss at least the regular season with a left foot injury. Williams almost 1,200 yards last season, fourth most in the SEC. But all is not lost for the Hogs. Rushing tack is not limited to Williams. Arkansas returns Alex Collins. Guy's pretty good. Fifth in the SEC last season with 1,100 rushing yards and 256-pound Cody Walker slides into a more prominent role after a big spring. Only Nick Chubb ran for more yards last season than Jonathan Williams among returning players in the SEC. His career 5.7 yards per carry ranks 6th in program history, and 900-yard games are tied for the 7th most in school history. Fortunately for Hog fans, Arkansas is not the only team in FBS with 2 players to run more than 1,000 yards as Alex Collins returns. Here's the head coach and Cody Walker on moving forward.
If there's one team in college football that could take a hit at the running back position, it's probably the Arkansas Razorbacks and not get phased too much. So we'll obviously regroup and do what we're doing, but it's not a setback in any way, shape, or form. It's an opportunity for others to take a step forward, and I'm excited about that. But obviously, we're the only team in college football with 2,000-yard rushers. Now we got one. But I said during the course of the summer, after last spring, watching Cody go, there's no doubt in my mind if Cody was in the number 2 spot in our offense, he could go for 1,000. I think Raleigh, I'd feel the same way about right now.
I mean, with the group of guys that we got, it's just next man up, and the mentality that we have in the room right now, it's just we got to eat. We got to keep going. The show doesn't stop.
Kind of funny when the guy said, we got to eat. You know they're going to be eating out in Fayetteville. So it's fitting that we start with how they run the ball. With the loss of Jonathan Williams, Clint, how much has this changed the outcome of this Arkansas team in 2015?
Well, with the emergence of Cody Walker in spring of last year, you think he can take a little bit of the load, but you're still a concern because you're down in numbers. In this offense, 2 backs, you'd like to get a little bit deeper than that. This fall camp, the true freshman, Raleigh Williams III, has come to play. He's shown up. He's physically able to play, which most freshmen are not. Number 2, he's mentally far beyond where most freshmen are as far as taking in the offense, being able to pass protect, being able to run the right routes, and he's got great hands. So this offensive coaching staff is extremely excited about this young man and feel really good about his ability to fill in as that third back.
So, Marcus, with that being said, what's the approach? Is it all Alex Collins? Is it a little bit of Cody Walker? Is it a little bit of running back by committee? What do you think that Dan Enos will run?
Well, first let me say it gets a lot scarier with this team having a 250-pound running back coming in second, but this has always been running back by committee. That's Brett Bielema's system. These guys thrive in this system because they're physical backs that can get it done. And sometimes you look at teams and you say, this guy's a one and a two. These guys are 1A and 1Bs. Yeah. So they're ready to play, and it'll end up the same way. Alex Collins is a real threat at running back. He'll be a draft pick on the next level. So I think they're fine. Obviously, losing Jonathan is a big deal. Probably inner squad more than on the outside, but these guys will be fine.
I think a big deal here is four offensive line starters coming back, but they're changing spots, Clint. I mean, you've got Dan Skipper that's moving. Denver Kirkland's going to the left tackle. How much, from a quarterback perspective, does that change the game when you have a lot of moving parts in the offensive line?
Well, I think it changes the game and your approach to spring ball and fall camp, but it doesn't change the game once the season starts. Denver Kirkland is moving to left tackle. He's a preseason All-American choice. He is a great player. He's got to get used to playing without another offensive lineman on his left. When you're in there in guards, you get a lot of protection. He's got to really get comfortable with that left side being exposed. But with a little bit of backs help, with Dan Enos and some good play calling there, you can really cover up for that left tackle being exposed. Across the board, again, they're as good as anybody in the country in what they do.
That offensive line last year, Brandon Allen only sacked 12 times in those 13 games. So let's talk a little Brandon Allen. And I tell you what, he's in pretty good company right now. If you look at what he's been able to do, Marcus, what do you take out of Brandon Allen coming in for his senior season?
Well, you think about efficiency when you think about him, 20 touchdowns to 5 interceptions. But more so than that, and I talked about this a lot last year with B.A., Brandon Allen, he needs to convert the big plays. We look at the Alabama game when he tries to go across field and gets picked off against Landon Collins. Give his team an extra possession, an extra series to try to go win games in the end. And I think he'll cross that hurdle with Dan Enos being there.
All right, so let's go quarterback on quarterback here. What do you see out of Brandon Allen, Clint, when you look at him in the pocket?
Well, this kid's a top five quarterback in this conference, and he can clearly play the position of quarterback. He's got plenty of arm strength. He moves in the pocket well. He does a lot of good things, well above average. So when you talk about Brandon Allen right here, he's throwing from the right hash against Texas. Hard left, the receiver catches the ball outside the numbers in tight coverage there with a DB over the top and underneath. Mm. That's arm strength, fellas. Yeah. That's the arm strength that has to get it done. Right here, he's learned Bielema's play action system, hard play action, flips his eyes, finds his keys, and rips a ball over the middle to a receiver again in a tight space. Again, arm strength is not a problem. Right here, he shows a little bit of mobility and vision. He rolls right, good feet right there to outrun that defensive end. He lowers his eyes, finds his underneath tight end right there and checks it down.
That's a good throw across the body.
Well, it's a smart throw. It's a smart throw. All college quarterbacks have the ability to make that throw, but vision is what's key. Footwork and vision and learning this system is where he's at.
Well, how about this? Good company for Brandon Allen, one of six quarterbacks last season to start every game and throw at least 20 touchdowns or 5 or fewer interceptions. The other on that list, pretty impressive, including Heisman Trophy winner Marcus Mariota and Brett Hundley. Only Kessler, Brissett, and Allen return among these six. So, when you look at that, what kind of season? What's the ceiling? Is it 25 touchdowns, 8 interceptions? Well, give me a stat line.
What you love about Brandon Allen coming back is the fact that they're not having quarterback questions at Arkansas. And I think that gives them an advantage of going into games with a little bit more surety than most of the teams. That's the biggest key to me with everybody in disarray about who will be their starter.
Right.
A lot more to come coming up, and we'll talk a little defense as well on the other side. Because, listen, Martrell Spate, Darius Filon, Trey Flowers, all gone from that great Arkansas defense in 2014. But these guys will tell us who's going to bounce back on D for them. And it's our favorite part, but also the most controversial part of the preview. We'll predict the entire 2015 Arkansas schedule game by game. And we'll give you a glimpse into our new show here at SEC Network, SEC Inside, where you'll get an exclusive Aztecs look into the Hogs team. No secret that Arkansas likes to run the ball. Well, that also takes time off the clock and wears down the opposing defenses. Nobody in the SEC was better than that than the Hogs last season. They reeled off 15 drives of 5-plus minutes, the most in the SEC. So how do they get ready for those long drives? Let's give you an SEC inside look.
Big day, big day. Start us off right here. Let's go, let's go. Straight to Indy, let's go.
Get these guys going today early. Come on, come on. Go, go, go. Fire those feet on contact. Boom, boom.
Stay on those blocks, boys.
All right.
Little Team Red, let's go. Everybody be talking, let's be crisp. Every yard matters. Little movement. Good shell, good shell, good shell. Go, 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 go. Good. Good job, Ho. Eyes up. Can't play with our eyes down. Get it to him. Get it to him. There you go. Good.
When you're dropping, you got to keep your eyes where? Yeah, I mean, that's the advantage of zone defense. When you're playing man, you turn your eyes, you know? What are you going to get today that you didn't get yesterday?
Stacking the route and, like, some of the underneath routes.
On the underneath routes? Is the underneath routes because you don't like the underneath, or do you just like the streets down
no,
the side?
Just,
you don't like to hit people. That's the whole reason we're trying to get you to settle, because if you settle where he's not, then you're gonna get the ball. Plus, he can't make what? He can't contact you, right? The whole foundation of our defense.
Yes, sir.
You can never let a guy cross your face.
Yes, sir.
Get rid of the ball. Can't take sacks down here.
18-yard line, right? We got a 35-yard field goal, right? Now you take an 8-yard sack, it takes out a field goal range. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So down here, that red zone means a whole lot of difference.
There it is, there it is.
There you go, there you go.
1 yard at a time, boy.
That's a great look at that, and that's a great look into our new show, SEC Inside. And that was a fall camp, but we're going to show you inside the game. September the 9th is the first one on a Wednesday. We will look at Vandy and Florida's first game, and you got to get ready for that, Marcus.
Oh, that's camp. Football time, man. I just wish the big fellas could get a slow-mo water drink on some of these highlights.
Listen, those are the times that you really miss, man. The intimate moments with the coaches, talking the details of the game, the heated practices with the players, bumping elbows with the guys. That's what you miss.
All right, well, what I don't miss is you two guys. So let's go ahead and talk a little bit of defense, shall we? How about this? From week 9 of last season, the best defense the SEC was Arkansas. Razorbacks allowed just 263 yards per game over those final 6 games, which was the second fewest allowed among FBS teams in that period. However, the Hogs must replace 5 starters on defense. That's right. Gone, Martrell Spate, his 128 tackles. Darius Filon, Trey Flowers, 10 sacks between those guys are gone. Who steps up for this defense?
Well, I think they're fine. I think Arkansas established some type of identity at the end of last year. I talked to Rod Smith about a couple guys, and he was real high on Bijan Jackson. He says he has the versatility as a defensive tackle, but he has the versatility to play nose or a 3-tech. And DeMarcus Hodge is another big fella that can man that nose spot to move Bijan out. Jamichael Winston, the defensive end, has emerged as a leader, and he thinks he has a little bit more flexibility moving Brooks Ellis to the middle spot in coverage and in defending the run. So I think they'll be fine. I think they want to create some of that production that they had last year at the end of the year.
Yeah, in talking to Coach Bielema, last year he was excited about a couple of great players, and that's why they were pretty good. Mm. This year, he's excited about having the opportunity to rotate 7 or 8 defensive linemen, which you can relate to,
absolutely,
Big Dog. Rotating seven or eight linemen is a beautiful thing. You never get tired, and you cannot get Coach Bielema to quit talking about it.
Well, of course, because he likes to talk about the big guys.
Right.
But what if the big guys don't get that same push that they had last year? What does this secondary bring to the table that they'll be in pretty good shape?
Well, some depth. You got Rohan Gaines at safety returning. You've got Jared Collins at corner returning. You've got a couple, Andre Tolliver, a couple of young guys that have come a long way. But one guy I think you need to keep an eye on in the secondary is Santos Ramirez. He's a bigger body, tall, lean kid that can bring the hat. Mm. He can also come down in the box and cover a slot receiver when he needs to. He's a former corner, guy that didn't play last year, is a true freshman because he was injured two different times. So look for him to really stand out. Another guy named Dre Greenlaw, safety, moved to linebacker. Look for him to really step up. And Jackie Harris, the old school tight end from the NFL, his son Josh Harris walked on and is going to get playing time this year at Mike.
How about those Arkansas Razorbacks? Fifth best in the NCAA FBS last year in red zone efficiency as well, too. They tightened up right there. And that's the reason why the fans are so excited out there in Fayetteville. Because, listen, they're at a fever pitch. And there they are with the head coach right there getting a couple pictures. Of course, Big Red ready to go as he fans got ready for 2015 Fan Day. And of course, the big men, huh? You got to show a little muscle right there, like Brandon Allen.
Yes, sir.
We better be careful. Right on his job. All right. Well, hey, the Arkansas Razorbacks, they finished last season at 7-6. How will they fare in 2015? Our guys give us a game-by-game breakdown coming up next. And if you knew that we were to talk about the Hogs, you knew that we were probably going to give some love to the big man, Sebastian Traytola.
Go.
They can hear everything. They have eyes everywhere, dude.
Let's go, CJ! Let's go, CJ!
Welcome back to the 2015 Arkansas Razorbacks football preview. Offensive lines are about size and consistency, and the Hogs, they got both. Looking forward to pounding the ball again. Remember, they were the only FBS team last season to have two 1,000-yard rushers. And oh, by the way, that offensive line, bigger than the Houston Texans. Arkansas, how about that media guide? Fantastic. All big five offensive linemen on the cover. I mean big, by the way. The group averages 6'6", 328. Dan Skipper, number 70 right there on the left-hand side, 6'10". One of those big men right there on the right, that's Sebastian Traytola, and we had him mic'd up for practice.
So I was told that I can be heard right now while the camera's on me. This is awkward. No matter where you are, they can hear everything. They have eyes everywhere, dude.
Crazy! That is crazy! Oh my god!
Welcome to 2015, huh?
Yeah. Coach Bitt, we got another one? Or good?
Hey, woo pig, baby.
Hey, woo pig! Hey, let's go, CJ! Let's go, CJ! Let's go, CJ! Let's go, CJ! Let's go, CJ!
Boy, they can move. So how about let's move to the next level, huh? Those big men on campus. Auburn and Georgia were the only SEC teams to average better than 3 yards a carry before the running back was ever touched. Arkansas averaged 2.8 yards a carry while facing an average of 7.3 defenders in the box, tied with LSU for the highest in the conference. Brett Bielema is ready for the season. I had a chance to talk with him early this summer.
Coach, what's been the hardest part about coaching in this conference?
Without a doubt, to see the disappointment in our players when we don't have success. As a coach, you're in this for a career. You know, you're going to be doing it hopefully for a long, long time. But players, you're on a limited window. You know, you got a 4 to 5 year window. And when you don't have success and you realize that window's closing, for me as a coach, that's hard to take.
What's been the biggest misconception about Arkansas football?
That we can't throw the ball. That gets a little frustrating, and it dates back to my first job. I took over for a guy that loved to run the football, Barry Alvarez, and we did a lot of things where we had success throwing the football and running the football for over 200 yards per game. And if you do that and are able to have that happen, 200 both running and throwing, you're going to win a lot of games.
And the guy that should be doing it is Brandon Allen this year. What he attended the Manning Passing Academy. What do you think he took from that experience?
Well, you know, just talking with him briefly about it, I think it kind of continued to show him that he belongs. You know, not a lot of preseason hype for him. You know, you got the other teams that have won some games. And, you know, it cracks me up when you got a freshman or sophomore who, because he was a five-star out of high school, people want to anoint him. we'll punch him in the mouth once, see what happens. You know, I think the part about B.A. is he's a guy that has been through a lot. He's a fifth-year senior. He's got a very live arm. He's got good players around him. He's got a chip on his shoulder, and I think great things can happen.
Nine offensive starters returning for you, which got to put a smile on your face. Four of them on that big offensive line. Where does this rank in all the offensive lines you've had an opportunity to coach?
Well, unfortunately, it's very good. I think it's the best one I've had at Arkansas, without a doubt. Had the good fortune to be around a lot of great offensive linemen and offensive lines in general. But this group is definitely one of the more entertaining. They call B.A. Their precious jewel. I don't know if I want to be called that by a bunch of men, but that's their prerogative. And I think it kind of shows how much our guys take pride in taking care of him.
Dan Enos, offensive coordinator, who was a head coach last year. Take us through that phone call you made to Dan to say, hey, I want you to be a coordinator.
You know, I've traditionally never really hired within the structure of normal. I didn't get hired in a normal way. You know, to this point, I've never really interviewed for a job yet. I've been given jobs based on what we've done, and I've kind of done that with my coordinators especially. I just kind of go in after people that I'm interested in, say, hey, do you have an interest? Let's talk a little details and see where it goes. And Dan was a very accomplished player. Then he became an accomplished assistant coach, an accomplished coordinator, and then a head coach. I think that part makes the whole thing work.
What makes Fayetteville and Hog fans so special?
Well, I think they're unique. You know, they're very similar in the fact that Fayetteville is a unique area because of the campus and all that goes with it. It gets to be a unique community, which creates a unique culture, which across the state creates a hog frenzy that is pretty hard to beat.
Lastly, what's the best piece of advice ever given to you?
You know, from a coaching perspective, I'll never forget this one. Coach Fry, who was my head coach at the time, a very, very successful coach, NCAA Hall of Fame coach, said before I became a head coach, he said, as a head coach, never coach something you don't know and never ignore something you do know. And it sounds a little complicated, but what he's basically saying, I think there's a lot of coaches, because they got a pride or an ego, jump into things that they don't really know what they're talking about. And then their coaches and their players lose respect because they know that they're faking it or they're you know, maybe BSing their way through it. Whereas if you know something as a head coach and you ignore it, you know it's wrong, you know that it needs to be corrected and you act like you didn't see it, it'll pop up again to the most worst possible scenario in time there can be. So that's been a big one for me. And then I go back to early in life. In life, if you always tell the truth, you'll never remember after what you said. And I think there's a lot of people that say certain things at certain times and then forget they said it.
Well, I think a lot of people are telling the truth that they're scared of that Arkansas Razorback team coming up out of Fayetteville. Coach, thanks for the time.
Thank you very much. Woo Pig.
Woo Pig, he does that. Back with Glenn Serner and Marcus Beers. My favorite part of the preview shows is I put these guys to the test. We go look at the schedule predictor. I asked the guys to go ahead and fill in the W's that they thought that were no-brainers, and there wasn't any disagreeing on five of those. But let's start with Texas A&M. Gentlemen, Marcus, what do you think? What happens?
It's a bit tricky. You know, this was a close game last year, and I just feel like Arkansas is going to get this one. They were a first down away from taking this game further, and they couldn't get it done. I think they get it done this year.
At Tennessee, Josh Dobbs, that team's excited. What do you got in front of Arkansas?
I like Arkansas, even though it is at Tennessee. I like Arkansas around. Two very similar football teams. I think Arkansas is probably a little bit further along with that experience at quarterback, that depth at defensive line. I like Arkansas.
All right, put it in there as a W. The Tide, ranked third in the AP to start the season. Marcus, what happens in that game?
This is what they do, and I don't know if Brandon Allen has turned that corner yet to make enough effective throws to beat Alabama. Alabama will be ready for the run game. They were ready last year. That's why I give Alabama the slight edge. So this is a loss for me in that game.
You taking a loss as well on that one, too?
I'm taking a loss. Alabama on the road, the chip on their shoulder from not playing as well last year. I like Alabama.
All right, so then they get a bye week. They face the Auburn Tigers coming in. Clint, what do you think happens against the Tigers?
Arkansas coming out of a bye week is typically pretty good. There's a lot of unknown about Auburn right now. Contrary to popular belief, I like Arkansas in that game.
I'm picking them to win this game.
You're picking them to win that game?
I'm picking Auburn to win this game.
Okay, so that's a dub. Yes. Oh, no. Hey, you know what?
We have a little disagreement, but to me, Auburn right now has to get over the hump, and it would take my credibility away for saying they'll win the West and lose to Arkansas.
But you know what? I'm going to put it up there as a W because of the bye week. They'll be ready to go. Ole Miss, LSU, back-to-back shutouts. Quickly, what happens there?
I think they go in and get one against Ole Miss. Ole Miss is a team that you really don't know how they're going to stand up up against this run game, they've struggled. So I give this a W for Arkansas.
LSU?
Yeah, I tell you what, I got a loss at LSU. LSU on the road, much like Alabama, it's too tough.
And to finish the season?
Always scary with Missouri, but this run game would be too vaunted. Too many losses up on that D-line.
So what do you got?
It's a W.
10-2, I think Hogs fans will take that.